Good morning, and welcome to our online worship for Easter Sunday at First United Methodist Church of Paxton. We're glad you're here with us this morning, and let's join together in our Easter greeting. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. I want to welcome all of you who are joining us on Facebook, and again, encourage you to post your comments as we experience this together this morning, and welcome those who are calling in on the conference line as well. And if you can, if you're on the conference call, if you can push *6 on your phone, that will mute your line so we can eliminate background noise. It doesn't really bother me, but it would help maybe a little bit. And since we're still under the stay-at-home order until the end of April, we're continuing with our online and conference call worship. I know that a lot of us are getting emotionally and maybe even physically tired, even though we're staying at home, but hopefully we are not spiritually tired. It's essential that we continue to follow these procedures and stay at home as much as possible, so we're glad to be able to provide this service online or on the phone. And again, we found that the music doesn't always come through real well on the phone, but please bear with us through this. And we want your feedback too. If you can send us a text message or a message on email, that would be great if you could do that and let us know about your experience of worshiping with us on the phone. Now, if you're a guest with us today and you haven't been with us before, we want to especially welcome you. And if you could send me your address in an email to john.hauck@gmail.com, I have a gift I would love to send to you. That's, again, john.hauck@gmail.com. And then I also have a gift for everyone for Easter, and since you can't be with us this morning, we're going to send you this little booklet in the mail this week, and hopefully you'll be able to read it and then maybe even share it with a friend or family member. I want to emphasize that all of us who are gathered here today in our homes, or the few of us that are here in the church sanctuary, are here to worship and celebrate the risen Christ together. And so we're glad that you're here. We have some good news going on around the church. Our trustees have been very busy, and we have construction going on in the shaft where the old elevator was to prepare for the new lift that will be coming in the next couple of weeks. And we also are going to be replacing the east middle steps that come up into the sanctuary area and putting a wider landing there. And that project is going to happen within the next couple weeks as well. So when you come back to church again, there are going to be some nice surprises for you. And if you were with us last week, you heard Greg Newell at the end of the service share about the process with the bell tower. I won't go into that today, but we are going to be doing some work on that in a few months as well. Again, I want to say a word about the offering this morning. Since we're not with together in person in worship, I do want to encourage you to please continue to send your offerings and thank those of you who've been doing this. It's wonderful to see the response of the offerings coming in the mail. So please send those to our church address at 210 West Center Street, Paxton, Illinois, 60957, or you can drop them in the mailbox that is secure by the entrance to the offices on Taft Street. And the mission offering this month is going to our church mission trip, which we are still hopeful that we will be able to do that this summer. And if not, we will wait and do it next summer and have that fund available for that. But thank you for your gifts to our offerings, our building fund, and our mission offering for our mission trip this summer. As usual, right now, with the stay-at-home order, there'll be no activities at the church this week, but we will continue with the evening devotion time at 7:30 on the church Facebook page or on the conference call, and we're glad for those of you who continue to join us in that way, Monday through Friday at 7:30 p.m. And thank you for those who are continuing to reach out to our older members and your neighbors and friends to give encouragement and to help with any needs that they may have during this time. Also want to remind everyone that the food pantry, the Hands of Christ food pantry, is open. We are working in cooperation with the PBL food pantry to be sure that people in our community get food during this time. And the PBL food pantry is closed, but ours is open, and we're getting food from them to help out. So if you need food or know somebody who needs food, please send them over on Saturdays between 9 and 11 a.m. And then one more reminder, if you haven't filled out your census form, it's important that we get those filled out so that we can get the money from the state and the federal government to support our needs here in Paxton and the surrounding area. So we want to encourage you to do that as well. I do want to point out as well, you may see behind me that we were able to get some Easter lilies and spring flowers to grace our sanctuary for this Easter Sunday, and it was an anonymous gift, but we want to say thank you to the person who provided those. And then also, if you ordered Easter flowers, we're going to be sending that out in the mail this week too, the brochure with the people who gave Easter flowers in memory or in honor of someone. And if you would like to get an Easter lily, if you ordered one, we can make those available. You just need to let us know. If you'll send us an email or a message, a text message, we'll make arrangements to get those to you at some point this coming week. And with that, I believe those are all of the announcements that I need to make at this time. And so we're going to join together in our worship. And as we get started this morning, we have a Happy Easter video clip that was inspired by the PBL school staff. And a few people want to greet you with a Happy Easter greeting. And I want to say thank you to Rob Pacey for putting this together for us.
Happy Easter to our church family. We love and miss you all.
Happy Easter! I really miss singing with you guys. Keep praising the Lord.
Hi. Have a happy Easter.
Happy Easter from the Hudsons.
Happy Easter! Christ is risen. I miss having all of you here together in the church sanctuary, and pray we'll be back together again soon. In the meantime, keep reading your Bible and keep praying, and God bless.
As we start our service this morning, let's join together in our call to worship. Shout for joy!
The tomb is empty.
Clap your hands!
Death has been defeated.
Dance and sing, for Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. We do have Sound the Trumpet this morning, and Yanni said 34 years that they've been doing this song at the beginning of worship. And so Andy and Sean are here on the trumpets, and Judy Voorhees on the organ. And let's listen to that, the sounds of the trumpet, and then that will lead into our opening hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
Thank you.
join with us now in our opening prayer, and those on the phone, if you could just listen along as we pray together. God of mystery and might, your amazing love always seems to catch us off guard. We come to the tomb expecting to find Jesus' body, but the tomb is empty. As we behold the glory of the resurrection, take us back to that moment of discovery when grief and loss gave way to hope and new life. As we shout our hallelujahs, remind us that despair was transformed into joy at the empty tomb. We join in the celebration of resurrection life as we pray in the strong name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We also have Jason Bowen with us this morning, and we are going to share with you a praise song this morning that you all know. We sing it a lot at Easter time. Because he lives, amen. Morning. It's a special day. It's Easter. Easter Sunday, and on special days, we sometimes like to give and receive gifts, like for birthdays or for Christmas. And so today, I have a couple of gifts here for Easter. Now, if you had to choose between these two gifts, which one do you think you would like to have? Let's see. Sometimes you shake a box to see if you can hear if there's something in it. That sounds like it's got something in it. Oh, that one doesn't sound like it has anything unless it's really packed in there. So let's open these gifts and see what's inside. First, I'll open up this one. And look at that. It's filled, not filled, but there's chocolate in there. That's the kind of gift that I would like to get for Easter. Chocolate. Okay, so that's a great gift. Well, let's open up the other box, and this one's just kind of taped together, and it's not even wrapped. So let's just see what's in this box here. Let's pull that tape back and look at this and see. Oh, look at that, it's empty. Would you want to get an empty gift for Easter? I don't think so, but let's think for just a moment about these two gifts. Maybe the empty box is like the best Easter present ever. Well, how is that? Well, the Bible tells us that after Jesus had died on the cross, his body was wrapped in a shroud of cloth and laid in a nearby tomb, and a large stone was rolled across the entrance to the tomb. But 3 days later, we all know what happened. Some of his followers went to the tomb to mourn and to continue to prepare his body for the burial, and they found a surprise there. The stone was rolled away, and the tomb was empty. Jesus was not there because he had been raised from the dead and left the tomb. The empty tomb was the best Easter Sunday present ever. So even today when we think of good news, we think about the empty tomb of Jesus, and that's the whole basis of our belief and our faith. Sometimes we use little plastic eggs like this, and we fill them with candy, and some of you might be having your own family Easter egg hunts today. This one's also filled with chocolate. But if you get an egg that's empty, like this one is, let it remind you that the tomb was also empty because Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's pray together. Loving and gracious God, we give you thanks this morning for the empty tomb. We thank you that Jesus could not be held captive by death. And because he is risen and because he lives, we can have life also, an eternal life with you. That is the best Easter gift ever. And for all of this, we give you our thanks and praise. Amen. I'd love to be able to share some chocolate with all of you kids, but have your moms and dads give you some chocolate at home. And when we all get back together again in the sanctuary for worship, I'll have some chocolate for you that day. Now we have another surprise gift for Easter Sunday. We have one of the families in our church, the Salvinas family, that has put together an Easter dramatic reading that we're going to share together.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him, went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the other linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and he believed. Mary, Peter, and the disciple Jesus loved went to the tomb and found it empty. Jesus' body was no longer there. Mary was distraught. Peter was confused. But the beloved disciple believed everything had happened as Jesus had said it would. After 3 days, all that remained was an empty tomb.
While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like light came stood beside them. In a fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the Son of Man must be delivered over the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be risen again. Then they remembered his words. It wasn't all for though this caught Jesus' followers completely by surprise. He had told them repeatedly that he was headed to Jerusalem to suffer and die, but somehow it didn't sink in. Maybe because this had never happened before. Now they were seeing the proof with their own eyes. Jesus was risen.
He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Jesus Christ before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who has destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. When Jesus went to the cross, his whole purpose was to save each one of us, you and me. He paid the debt for every sin that anyone ever committed or ever would commit, so anyone could come to him in faith and be saved. And to prove that he had canceled the power of sin and death, he rose again. Praise God for our mighty Savior.
Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last triumph. For the triumph will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Death is something we all face, but it is no longer something to fear. When we believe in Jesus, he frees us from the power of sin and death. He is not only overcomes them, but gives us victory over them. In his resurrection, Jesus gives us triumph.
Thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey your heart the pattern of teaching that has now claimed your allegiance. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Everybody sins. That's what separates us from a relationship with God. But that's not the plan God has for our lives. God's plan is for us to believe in and obey his Son, Jesus. By his death and resurrection, Jesus frees us from slavery to sin and gives us the gift of eternal life.
Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" This verse seems a little out of place. It comes from the story of the raising of Lazarus. But what it reminds us is that even before he went to the cross, Jesus had power over death. By his death, he freed us from the sins that separates us from God and made it possible for all of us to receive forgiveness and to overcome sin and death. And everything we have to do is this: believe in him. He still asking each one of us the simple question: do you believe this? Thank God for the power of Christ and in his gracious resurrection.
There is an empty tomb that proves Jesus was arisen. Our Savior has triumphed over sin and death. He offers us eternal life through the power of his resurrection.
Amen. Amen. We want to thank the Slovenas family for putting that video together with the dramatic reading for us this morning. And aren't those girls cute? They did such a great job with that. Now it's time for our prayer time this morning, and as we lift up our joys and concerns, some people have contacted me with some updates that we want to ask for prayers for this this morning, and I want to begin by asking prayers for Arlene Coulter, one of our older members. She is not doing very well with her health, and so we're asking prayers for her and healing and comfort for her health concerns right now. Also, I want to praise God that Mike White's aunt, Pearl Adams, is still recovering at home from a mild stroke and doing better, so praise God for that. And then, of course, we want to pray for those who are affected by the coronavirus, COVID-19, and continue to keep all of them in prayer, as well as the healthcare workers and the first responders and those who work in restaurants and those who work in grocery stores and other places, the truck drivers who keep the goods coming to all of our stores that keep us going during this time, and please keep all of them in prayer. And then, of course, continue to remember the Morrison family in the loss of Ron's brother, Ken, who passed away a little over a week ago. Please keep them in prayer. I got an update from Mary Jo Pilcher last night that her friends down in Florida, Roxy and Jim Fike, are doing better. Roxy is still recovering at home and feeling a little better. And Jim is finally off the ventilator after 8 days, but he's still very weak. And so we ask for continued prayers for Roxy and for Jim as they're recovering from the coronavirus. And then again, thank you to those who are helping out with the family from Uganda, Charles and Destiny, and helping to meet their needs during this time. They are very grateful for the food and all the things that they have received to help them out while they are still here with us, waiting for Uganda to open up again so that they can get back home. And then I got a call from Jane Coulter last night, and Luke and Jamie Ulrich, who we support as missionaries in Malawi, are trying to get back home to the States. They were planning to come home and do some touring among the churches that support them this summer, but they haven't been able to get a flight out yet. But they are going to be talking to the U.S. Embassy this week about the possibility of getting a direct flight from Malawi to Washington, D.C., and then on to Chicago. And we ask you prayers for them as they work this out, that it will work out so that they will be able to get back home to us again with their 3 kids and be able to be with us and share in our churches throughout this spring and summer about their work that they're doing over in Malawi. And I believe those are all of the updates I have for prayer requests this morning. So let's join our hearts together as we go to the Lord in prayer. Loving and gracious God, we are truly grateful that we come together on this Easter Sunday to celebrate the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, that he is alive again and the tomb is empty. There is no greater news in all the world, and we rejoice and give you praise for what you have done among us in bringing him back to life and him giving us eternal life with the sacrifice that he made and his resurrection. We are truly thankful, Lord. As we lift up to you this morning the joys and concerns of your people, we are thankful, Lord, for the healings that we're seeing of people that have gone through this coronavirus and are recovering and coming out well on the other side of it. But we also mourn with those families who've lost loved ones. And we ask your comfort and your care for those that are not able to be with loved ones in the hospital, especially when they are dying from this and not even able to have a full funeral service. We pray for your comfort and your peace for them in this difficult time. We continue to lift up the healthcare workers and those who are on the front lines, the first responders, the EMTs, police officers, firefighters, anyone who is out there still doing their job in the midst of this, as well as the pharmacists and the grocers and the restaurant workers and everybody that is trying to keep things going. And we pray to you, Lord, for those who have been laid off or lost their jobs in the midst of this, for their financial needs, that we can reach out and do our part to help do what we can to meet needs of people in this very difficult time. We lift up those who are struggling with health concerns other than this virus and pray for your hand to be upon them, to give them strength, to give them healing and restoration. And we pray for those closer to home who've lost loved ones as well, that you'll wrap your arms around them and comfort them in this time of their grief. And Lord, we pray for our nation and our world to continue to come together and work together to seek a way through this, and to know that you are still in control, that you are still on your throne. We pray for the leaders, for the government leaders as well as the healthcare leaders that are on the forefront of keeping us informed about what we need to do, and help us to pay attention and do those things that will bring it into this more quickly. And Lord, we also lift up our military personnel and those that are affected by the virus, but those who are continuing to be on the front lines in foreign countries to help keep us safe and keep people safe in other lands as well. We pray that as they complete their duty, they may return home safely to family. And we pray for those who lost loved ones on the battlefield too. Wrap your arms around all of us in this time and lift us up and give us encouragement and strength as we continue to move forward and as we continue to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ and that you are still on your throne in heaven. We give you all the praise and all the glory as we pray together in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, praying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we have another surprise, and we've got Jason coming up again to share some special music with us. Watch the Lamb.
Walking on the road to Jerusalem, the time had come to sacrifice again. My two small sons, they walked beside me on the road. The reason that they came was to watch the Lamb. Why? gave him none. The second one was violent. He was arrogant and loud. I can still hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, "There's Jesus," and I scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross and falling on the ground. I watched him as he struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back, grabbing at the yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Till a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, "You carry his cross!" At first, I tried to resist him, but his hand reached for his sword. So I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder, started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was now running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. On the cross, I heard him pray, "Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other's eyes. To thy hands I commit my spirit," he prayed, and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years, lost all sense of time, till I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, "Father, please forgive us, the Lamb."
Were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." May God bless this reading and hearing of his word for this day, for this is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. The scripture this morning leads us into the sermon title, which is "Come and See, Then Go and Tell." And I've shared this story before in various places and churches, but around the year 1930, a communist leader named Nikolai Bukharin journeyed from Moscow to Kiev in the Ukraine. His mission was to address a huge assembly with the aim of advancing communism. His subject for the evening was atheism, trying to get the people to turn away from God and convince them there was no God. For a solid hour, he aimed his heavy artillery at Christianity, hurling arguments and ridiculing the Christian faith. At last, he was finished, and he viewed what seemed to be the smoldering ashes of the people's faith in the crowd. "Are there any questions?" Bukharin demanded. A solitary man arose and asked permission to speak. He mounted the platform and moved close to the communist leader. The audience was breathlessly silent as the man surveyed them, first to the right, then to the left, and at last he shouted the ancient Orthodox Christian greeting, "Christ is risen!" The vast assembly arose as one person, and the response came crashing like the sound of an avalanche. "He is risen indeed!" The tomb where Jesus was laid on Good Friday is now completely different. It requires a different type of watcher. It does not need a cemetery caretaker or a company of Roman soldiers assigned to watch the dead, but rather an angel from heaven to announce the good news that Jesus is risen indeed. Do you think there was any significance to the fact that the stone enclosing the tomb of Jesus was rolled away? The stone didn't need to be rolled away in order for Jesus to leave the tomb. Perhaps an empty tomb with the Roman seal still affixed to the closed stone would have been an even more convincing proof of the resurrection versus the alternative theories that the Jewish leaders and Romans came up with. Was the stone moved in order to release Jesus from the tomb? Of course not. Being God, Jesus could move freely from one place to another without being restricted with the worldly limitations. So let's assume the stone wasn't rolled away for just a moment, but that Jesus began appearing to his disciples. Word would spread. The Jewish leaders likely would have had the tomb inspected. And if the stone was still in place and the seal was still affixed, they would have opened the tomb and found that the body of Jesus was not there. Then they would have been hard-pressed to claim that the body had been stolen or that he really wasn't dead after all and had been revived and somehow had gotten out of that tomb. Obviously, God decided that the stone would be rolled away. The stone covering the entrance to the tomb was there for many reasons, but we know it wasn't there in order to contain Jesus and keep him inside. So why was the stone rolled away? Well, before we answer that question, let's visit the importance of the guards that were there on that resurrection day. They had been placed there as an integral part in God's plan to communicate the resurrection. They were special soldiers, hand-picked for being the strongest, most skillful, alert, and soldiers who were loyal to the death. Their posting there was made the day after Jesus' burial as a last-minute decision to ensure that these zealots, these disciples who followed Jesus, would not go and kidnap his body out of the tomb. Both the authorities and the disciples had something to prove here. The Pharisees and the religious leaders wanted Jesus to lay in that tomb and his body to decay as a public demonstration that their motives were correct. The disciples, on the other hand, wanted proof that Jesus was, in fact, the risen Messiah and Lord. As the guards were keeping their watch, suddenly, in the blink of an eye, the stone was rolled away, and they saw the tomb was empty, and the angel was there who had been sent by God. Matthew 28, verse 4 records that they were as dead men because they had met a heavenly being. And I've said this before, you really don't want to see an angel, because angels are huge, imposing, heavenly creatures. I'm sure that these hand-picked soldiers were in a situation here that they've never encountered before, and it was such a significant event that they froze in place like dead men. They certainly weren't prepared or trained for this, so they quickly, when they came to their senses, ran off to their commanders and then to Pilate to report on what had happened. Now, I wouldn't have wanted to be in their shoes, because the penalty for letting someone escape from a prison was death, and even more so if a body was taken out of a tomb. Their superiors were not happy. And although they would discipline them for failing in their duty, they couldn't deny the truth of what these trained professionals had shared with them about Jesus being gone from the tomb. The authorities knew that they spoke the truth, the soldiers did, so they paid the guards in order to keep them silent. We're told that later in Matthew 28. It was a brilliant, God-inspired strategy to use those professional, loyal soldiers to share the truth of the resurrection with those who denied that Jesus was the Messiah. Who better to challenge a skeptic than these Roman guards? Well, what we need is the resurrection power in our lives, manifested by that stone being rolled away from the tomb. You see, the stone was rolled away as a witness to Jesus' followers that he could not be held by death. When the women arrived at the empty tomb, the angel said to them, "Come and see." Jesus had said about himself in John 11:25 in the story of the raising of Lazarus, "I am the resurrection and the life." In other words, resurrection power centers in Jesus. And in him, we can tap into that resurrection power. Paul knew the vital importance of walking in that power, and he revealed it when he said in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, "I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection." The power of his resurrection must be the power in our lives as well. It can only become so when we surrender ourselves to the one who rose again from the dead. And he calls us today not to come to his cross, for he is no longer there. He calls us not to come to the tomb, for he is no longer there either. But he calls us from the right hand of the Father in heaven. From there, one day, he will come back to set up his kingdom here on earth. He will come to judge the living and the dead. And they will all stand before him, for he is the resurrected Lord. He calls to us today, saying, "Look at what I did just for you. Come and see and follow me." The stone was rolled away so that the women, the disciples, and we could look into that empty tomb. It was rolled away for our sakes, so that the empty tomb could be visible to all. The empty tomb is the greatest evidence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ in all of history. And I believe that it is indisputable evidence of his being raised from the dead. Skeptics and critics have tried to explain it away, and they've not been able to. The empty tomb still stands as evidence that Jesus is alive again, that the bonds of death could not hold him. He is alive today. And there is no other explanation. Some say it was the wrong tomb. But if it were the wrong tomb, the religious leaders who put Jesus to death certainly would have gone to the right tomb and produced his body. But they were unable to, because it was the right tomb, and it was empty. All of the great religious leaders of human history have lived and died, and their bodies are still in the graves to this day, except for Jesus Christ. Only he rose from the dead. Only Jesus broke the bonds of death and hell and came back victorious from the tomb and from death. So the significance of the stone rolled away is found in the words of the angel. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. The gospel message is that Jesus Christ lived, died, was buried, and rose again from the dead. The angel even gave the directive to the women, come and see, to provide the proof that they needed. Skeptics have denied it, the philosophers have tried to explain it away, but the tomb is still empty. He is alive. And had he not come forth from that tomb that day, he would have been shown to be a fraud, a fake. He would not have been our Savior, and we would still be living in our sins. There would be no hope for our future, no power for living now. But on that first resurrection morning, he rose from the dead. The tomb was opened to show that something tangible, something real had happened. Who would have believed the resurrection if the stone was still in place and the seal was unbroken? It was an open, public statement of the power of God. The stone had been rolled away, the guards had seen the angel of the Lord, and the tomb was now empty. And each of these incidents confirms what has become public knowledge about Jesus' prophecy of his own resurrection. The rolling away of the stone became a symbol to all that Jesus Christ truly is the real Messiah and the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now you have to wonder what the disciples would have done if the stone had not been rolled away. Would they have gone back into hiding, frightened that what they had believed was not true? I'm sure the hours turned into days after Jesus' death on the cross would have been filled with nervous anticipation, waiting and not knowing what to expect. For in John 20, verse 9, it says they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. But on seeing the empty tomb, the scene on that first Easter Sunday morning was one of action. There was disbelief, fear of Jesus' body having been taken by the authorities, but then the heavenly beings and angels began to speak to the women. And the women, and then later Peter and John, were running to tell others, as the angels had given them instructions to go and tell. You can almost see those who love Jesus sprinting to see his open and empty tomb and then running off to tell the others. The women received a command to depart from the tomb. The angelic message is a direct message. It calls for action, for engagement on our part. The angel says to the women, go and tell. Are we living as though our Lord is risen and living within our hearts today? Are we sharing the message that he lives with other people? We're not to linger near the empty tomb, even in these days of being physically distanced from one another with a stay-at-home order. We're not to linger near the tomb, but we're to take the good news that the tomb is empty, that Jesus is alive. The message of the resurrection calls us to action. It calls us to engage in the work of our risen Lord. And then there's also a command to deliver the good news. The angel said, go quickly and tell. The word quickly here means go without delay. These women were commanded to go with a sense of urgency, spreading the good news that Jesus Christ was risen from the dead. And notice that when Jesus met them as they ran from the tomb to go tell the disciples, we have a double directive here as Jesus also says to them, go and tell. Why the urgency? Well, because everyday people are still dying and struggling with sin. People are being deceived by the enemy to not believe in God or Jesus Christ. The message of the tomb is still the message for us today. Come and see, and then go quickly and tell. The message that we've been given is an urgent message. The women were to go and tell the good news that Jesus was risen from the dead. Those disciples who were cowering in fear that the cross might be their own coming soon were to receive the glorious great news that Jesus had conquered death and was alive forevermore. What a glorious message those women were given on that day. It was a message of hope, a message of life, a message of victory over sin and death. It was a message that everyone needed to hear. It still is. May we never forget that the message of that tomb is as fresh today as it was 2,000 years ago. Jesus is still alive, and people trapped in the bondage of their fear and sin still need to hear that message today. May we do as they did, and carry the message with swift feet and joyful hearts to a world that needs desperately to hear about our risen Lord. Have you experienced the great good news from that empty tomb from 2,000 years ago? Is Jesus your Savior today? Are you ready to meet him? Does the risen Lord live in your heart? He wants to. And if he is calling you to come to him, you need to come and see that he is alive today. And then you need to go and tell the great good news to others that Christ is risen. And always remember that saying of the Orthodox Church, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. And remember also that God is still on his throne. Let's pray together. Loving God, we thank you for this Easter and for the message that you gave to the women to go, come and see that the tomb was empty, and then go and tell quickly that Jesus was risen from the dead. May that message resonate in our hearts and lives today as well as we share this great good news throughout the world that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. We'll give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Now let's join in our closing hymn this morning, another favorite for Easter, He Lives.
Just the time.
As we close today, just a couple of reminders. I want to thank you for joining us on this Easter Sunday for our Easter worship celebration, and remind you that on Monday through Friday nights this week, we will have our evening devotion time at 7:30, coming to you from the church parsonage. And then also remind you to please continue to send in your offerings and your tithes. We do appreciate your faithfulness in doing this. We hope that you all have a wonderful and happy Easter, for Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Let's pray together. Loving God, we thank you that Jesus is alive. And as we go forth today, may we take that message in our hearts and on our lips that Jesus Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. And we give you all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for joining us.